of the hour. It is now 3 o'clock Central Time. And we're gonna go ahead and get started with our presentation today. I wanna introduce Juliet Jones, who has helped organize this entire series. So Juliet, you go ahead and kick it off and then we'll get started with our presenter.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Martin. Thank you very much. I'm Juliet Jones. I'm with Universal Family Connection. We are a Black-owned, women-owned social service organization. We're centered on the south side of Chicago. We have two offices, one in the Beverly area, and then we also have one in the Auburn Gresham community. So I'd like to welcome you all to our webinar. Our webinar, our bi-weekly webinar features, and we want to showcase Black medical professionals that can bring something to the table to help us as Black women access healthcare in a more unified way. So thank you for joining our webinar today. So thank you very much. Let me just explain about how we became who we are. Universal Family Connection, we held 5 focus groups on the west side, north side, and 2 on the south side. We held on the far south side. And then we also held a focus group with African-American women. And we wanted to hear the voices of 100 plus Black women. And that's what we did. We heard their voice on their successes or disparities in accessing healthcare. So what we did was we saw that there was a high priority that needed to be done so that we can build a structural intervention to really get at the women voices. We found that there were lots of health inequities and health disparities going on in those communities of Black and African women. So from the focus group, we built a work group, and a work group comprised of the women who attended each of the support group, and they were voted in by the women who attended the focus groups. And they formed a work group called BWSEF, is Black Women Supporting Empowering Lifestyle Factors. And what the BWSEF was charged with is to come up with a structural intervention so that we can help Black women as a community, not individually, as a community, on dealing with health inequities and health disparities that they are being faced with when it comes to going to the doctor or even making a call for a doctor, even in accessing, you know, health care by way of insurance. There was a lot of discrimination that was coming from the front desk. And so the BWSEF work group women found a need to organize and develop a structural intervention. And the name of that structural intervention is Our Power, Our Voice, Our Control. And what we're doing is having bi-monthly webinars bi-monthly webinars featuring Black medical providers that can help the women dispel some of the health disparities by educating them on what they need to know about themselves medically and hearing their voices. Then also we hope that the Black medical providers can also help with some of the inequities that's going on in the health industry. So it's not about complaining, it's about bringing some result to help us live the best life possible as a community of Black women, as I said, not individually. And so one of the series that we have, we want to focus only on Black medical providers. It's like a for us, by us. And we also want to learn from the medical providers as well as the medical provider hearing us as Black women on our concerns as well. And we also instituting surveys. We want surveys to go out to different clinics, anyone in the health industry who can help get the survey out on making sure that Black women are being helped when they go to the doctor. We want to be able to not just, like I said, to complain about those health inequities. We want to end it. We want to help end it. So the survey helps us do that. So I will be sending out surveys to as many Black medical providers as possible. And they're not just Black medical providers. We want clinics and hospitals that have Black women as patients. So that's important. So I will be calling on you all for that help. So thank you once again for joining in. So thank you very much. Thank you. And we have two invited Black medical women providers. One is Lovea Smith, and then the other one is Dr. Latanya Morris. Excuse me, Dr. Latanya Morris. So we're going to start our series off with Lovea. And so let me read her bio about Lovea Smith, and please correct me if I'm saying it wrong. Lovea Smith, she's an MA, she's an LCPC, is an independent clinical consultant, therapist, and trainer. Most recently, she was a director of support services at Housing Opportunities for Women, known as HOW. Lovea began her career in corrections at the Cook County Department of Corrections Women's Justice Services, where she became interested in domestic violence, women's issues, and homelessness. Lovea has worked in social services for more than 17 years with various agencies throughout Chicago, Northwest Indiana, and Normal, Illinois, and most recently providing therapy to clients using an online portal through web-based interactions such as text, phone, and video. Lovea is a Chicago native and the oldest of four children and mother to one daughter, Ashira. She earned her bachelor's degree in psychology from Illinois State University in 2004. She later graduated from Chicago School of Professional Psychology in 2007 and obtained a master's in clinical psychology with an emphasis in counseling. So we'd like to welcome Lovea Smith to our third series of our Black medical providers. Thank you, Lovea.
Thank you so much, Juliet, for that introduction. And thank you everyone for kind of having me on. And good afternoon, everybody. And I'm glad to be a part of you all afternoon. And I'm thankful that you all allowed me to kind of share part of your day with me. So I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen so that we can go ahead and jump into the presentation. Give me one second. Okay, can you guys see that okay?
Yep, we can see it. You can okay. Go ahead and go into presenter mode.
Okay, one second. Okay. And can you guys still see that?
Yep, we can still see it. It looks good.
Okay, great. All right, everybody. So the name of this presentation is Getting Your Groove Back. And I've done this presentation several times. I think I first did this presentation. I think it just kind of went on its own. I did this presentation with my cohort, Willie Warriors, for the very first time back in 2018, I believe. And I did it again in 19. And I've done different variations of this. And so I was asked to do this this training for to target more of Black women who are living with HIV. So we're going to go ahead and just jump right into it. So we're looking at how do we start to take care of ourselves in this. So our objectives for today, we're going to be defining the concepts of self-care versus self-comfort, learning how and when to say no, having that accountability, HIV in the Black woman. I did a duplicate. I apologize for that. And then like historical aspects of self-care. So at the top, you'll see that you'll see at the top that if you don't define yourself for yourself, you will be crunched into other people's fantasies for you and eaten alive. A quote by Audre Lorde that I really like, where she talks a lot about, you know, the importance of self-care and it being kind of this radical kind of way to be able to kind of manage who you are as an individual. So we're going to talk about, hold on one second. It is like going on its own. Hold on, technical difficulties. Sorry about that. So we're going to define like what is good stress and what is bad stress. So routine stress is just basically the pressures from every day. So going to work, an interview maybe, being a mom or whatever the case may be. This is all routine stress. This is what we're supposed, you know, we're supposed to be under some level of stress on a day-to-day basis. It helps us function and get throughout the day. Then you have immediate stress that's brought on by something significantly that has changed. Maybe it was like a job loss, maybe there was a divorce, or maybe there was some kind of diagnosis that you might have just gotten. And then you have something that's called traumatic stress, which is a tragic event like a car accident or some sort of assault. So these are the three types of stress, but understanding that routine stress is like your everyday kind of stress that we're all under on a day-to-day basis, and being able to kind of function to be able to navigate through those stresses is going to be important when it comes to being able to take care of yourself. So as a therapist, I am someone who follows Psychology Today and the APA. And so these are three different definitions that I took, the definitions of self-care. So according to Psychology Today, it's choosing behaviors that balance the effects of emotional and physical factors. It's knowing when your limits are, what your limits are and who you are, and recognizing that you're being pushed to the limit more so than you should be. According to APA, it is providing adequate attention to one's own physical and psychological well-being. And then just our definition out of the dictionary, the practice of taking action to preserve one's own health and taking an active role in protecting your own well-being and your happiness during those times of stress that we just defined. So let's kind of get into the burden of HIV with Black women. So as we all know that Black women are just disproportionately experiencing this infection, like we're being diagnosed with this infection, and we face these barriers to maintaining and accessing care. So according to the CDC, Black women have the highest risk of infection when you compare to our counterparts. Even though Black women only make up 14% of the female population, 60% of women who are diagnosed with HIV are Black women, and that is an alarming rate to see that in writing. 55% of women who live with HIV have experienced some type of intimate partner violence. And so this is a direct correlation to them decreasing the ability to be able to get care, because if you are in a domestic violence situation, if you're in a domestic violence situation, you're going to be less inclined to go and seek care because you don't want the stigma of that, the abuse that you're going through. You don't want that to be something that is recognized. You have a decrease in maintaining your care. This is also going to increase your viral load because you're not on medication. And of course, that's going to put more stress on you mentally. And then you may even have like an undiagnosed kind of mental illness. Maybe it's anxiety or depression, things of that nature. So as Black women, we face a number of societal, psychosocial, and personal challenges that can drastically impact our ability to access care and be able to successfully progress through this care continuum. And as you can see, there's a list of things here: poverty, substance use, the stigma of HIV, having low health literacy, like if you're in, you know, if you have like a GED level of education, unstable housing or employment, all of these things can really impact your ability to be able to kind of go out and get the care that's needed in the community. So let's look at this racial indifference. So shortly after ADA approved the PrEP in 2012, there was a CDC study that found that 500,000 African-Americans and 300,000 Latinos could have benefited from the drug, but only 7,000 African-Americans and 7,600 Latinos were actually taking it. So it just goes to show how informed we are about this drug and how much we can actually have access to that, but so little of us are taking those levels of precaution, excuse me. If these rates persist, CDC says that 1 in 48 Black women may be diagnosed with HIV in their lifetime, compared to 1 in 227 Hispanic women and 1 in 880 women who are white. There was a recent study that was done in Chicago, and I'll pull out more of the findings in that in this next slide, that only 30% of HIV negative Black women, so maybe they came in for like a STD, maybe it was gonorrhea or chlamydia, had reported that they had heard of it, but most of them learned about it through advertisements, you know, something on TV, maybe a billboard, something of those sorts, but not from a medical provider. So breaking that down even more, what they found was that at-risk adolescents of color were more likely to have never heard of the PrEP and had never gotten an HIV test. Despite this HIV prevalence that are among transgender individuals, PrEP use is really low. And even people who learn about the PrEP, they heard that there were good things about it. At-risk cisgender women of color were underinformed about PrEP and potentially about their own HIV risk levels. But primary care providers have a key role in playing the education and the uptake of that. And there may be a promise for a third PrEP dosing option available to the two most common approaches, daily and on demand. And hopefully Dr. Latanya Morris can speak more to that as we go into our panel discussion. So let's move into historically what happens when we don't take care of ourselves. So for centuries, we have found ourselves to be women of color who take care of, you know, we take care of people in nursing homes. We're mostly essential workers. We're in factories. We are, you know, bedside manner, you know, we're nurses. And then even going back in time as slaves, we were actually taking care of the homes of our slave owners. We were taking care of the children. We were maids, you know, all of these kind of things. And so there's always been this dynamic or this paradigm that the man is the breadwinner and the woman takes care of everything in the home, including the kids and things of that nature. So we're built to take care of other people. But historically, when you don't take care of yourself, in theory, that means that you're disposable, right? So in if we go by that definition, let's say you're doing spring cleaning. In springtime, you're going through your closets, you're throwing away that old dress that you just have not worn and who knows how long or whatever the case may be. And you no longer have any value of that. So if we affirm that, then we're saying that Black women are disposable. So we have to learn how to take care of ourselves and when to take care of ourselves. Because I know everybody on this webinar, we're not disposable. We don't think of ourselves as disposable. So we have to make sure that we're putting ourselves as a priority. So how do we start to do that? How do I take care of myself? So it's important, like she said in my bio, I'm also a mental health therapist, right, by trade. So I talk to my clients a lot about the importance of feeling their emotions. So when I say feel the emotions, I'm not saying just sit and wallow in those emotions and let them overcome you. Feeling the emotions, we have a limbic system for a reason. So it's important for you, like if you have hurt, if you have pain, if you have sadness, if you have anger, if there's happiness, you should feel what those emotions are and allow your body to naturally release what those feelings are. If it's happiness and you want to smile big, you know, you should be allowed to smile big, whatever that is. If it's sadness and your body is evoked to shed tears, you should allow yourself to do those things. When we compress those feelings, we then turn on our bodies pretty much, because our bodies are built to express this emotion for a reason. Just like when you have to go to the bathroom, your body, after you eat or drink, your body is going to expel what it does not need. And that's called waste. And that's the same thing with our feelings and our emotions. We have to be able to release those feelings in a natural way. And then we kind of progressively go through those things. So feel the feelings about what this diagnosis has done. Educating yourself is so important. The more educated you are, the more empowered you can be in taking the necessary steps to stand on top of this virus as opposed to it standing on top of you. Making sure that you ask for questions and then accept the help. You know, sometimes we're so, you know, independent. That's what we've learned how to do. I don't need anybody. And it's embarrassing for me to go and ask for help. But we were born into this world being helped being helped by someone. You know, we could not survive on our own. So our parents took care of us. If you know, you're coming into this world, someone took care of you. And along the line of society, we got into this mindset that we don't need help. That is absolutely the opposite of what we're talking about today. Learn to ask for help and being okay with asking for help. Research the providers who accept your insurance. You know, try to obtain like a doctor that's at an office versus a clinic, because, you know, my work in the clinic, and I'm sure that LaTanya can kind of speak more to this as well. When I worked in the clinic, providers were really under the crunch and under the wire for just kind of getting a quota in, you know? So it's like, I'm just coming in, I'm just kind of slapping a Band-Aid on things, I'm making sure everything's okay, and then I'm pushing you out of the door because I have to make this next, I have to get to this next client or this next patient. And sometimes that could feel like belittling, or, you know, feeling like you're missed over, or you're, you know, you're looked over, and you might have questions, or maybe you don't know the questions to ask. But sometimes not all clinics have doctors who are ill-informed. So you wanna make sure that you're researching the doctors that you're trying to get your assistance from. Pay attention to the foods that you're taking in. So if we're consuming a lot of comfort foods like junk food and things of that nature, of course, that's going to counterplay what your viral load is kind of speaking to. So you wanna make sure that you're eating good foods, healthy foods, you know, minimizing how much junk. It's okay for you to have comfort foods, but everything in moderation. And at the end of all of that, you wanna be kind to yourself. I can't express that enough, that the things that you're saying about yourself outwardly to people, people will then start to believe that about you. And so we internalize those things, and then we can kind of be hard on ourselves, but it's important for you to show the same grace and gratitude and kindness that you show to other people. You need to show that to yourself as well. So again, Audrey Lorde says self-care is an act of political warfare. So on this slide, we're going to talk about, what do you need? Is it comfort or is it care that you need? So when you need comfort, you may need to take a break. You may need to have pleasure that might look like, you know, sex, or, you know, you might need a warm hug or anything like that. Maybe it's a, you know, a glass of wine, those kind of things. Maybe you need to be soothed from a disappointment that you got, or relaxation from a stressful day. That may be okay when you have to have comfort. It's just a little break in there. Maybe I need to go out with my girlfriends, or you know, whoever it is that provides me some inspiration or insight to, you know, trying to help me boost my morale. That is okay to kind of have those comforting kind of things. When you need care, you might actually need, you know, self-respect. Maybe you need to be realigned. You need to be reconnected with individuals. Those kind of things are kind of happening. And you're missing that kindness, again, that I talked about in the last slide. Excuse me. And you want to be realigned with your strengths and your values. This is probably when there's more a need for that self-care to kind of come into play. So let's break that down a bit more. So if you have a craving for ice cream, or you need sex to decompress or exercise, that glass of wine that I talked about, maybe you want to go buy yourself something nice or take yourself out to dinner and treat yourself, comfort is then good. But when these things then turn into habitual behaviors, you're now eating a tub of ice cream, you're now going through two bottles of wine, you're now transferring from wine to like harder alcohol, maybe that sex then turns into multiple sex partners. If you're going and you're doing shopping sprees and you're spending money that you really don't necessarily have, or you're going to dinner every single night, this is probably when you need to look at things, reevaluate, and then determine, maybe I need something else. This is when you need care. So paying attention to those numbness kind of feelings, that avoidance from, you know, people, maybe you're isolating and shutting down, or you're overindulging in things. You're sitting in front of the TV and you're just watching a lot of mindless kind of episodes of reality TV, like The Real Housewives of Atlanta. Nothing's being productive. You look around your apartment or your house and you see that there's just stuff everywhere. This is when self-care is probably gonna be more important. And then that's time for you to kind of do some other things. So I want to kind of walk you through like an exercise, if you all are okay with that. How are we on time, Brittany?
I think we're good. We should do it.
Okay, great. So this is an activity that I created that that oftentimes when we want to kind of go away, have a vacation, we're not always privy to that. Maybe it's the money, maybe it's the time on our job or whatever it is going on in our lives that we can't really have a physical getaway. So sometimes you have to kind of create a space in your mind that you can kind of go to kind of break away from things. So I want you all to kind of close your eyes with this. Get as comfortable as you can, wherever you are sitting or laying, whatever it is, get as comfortable as you can in the space. And I want you to just listen to my voice. So you're gonna go ahead and close your eyes. I want your feet to be flat on the floor. Taking a deep breath through your nose for 4 seconds, 2, 3, 4. You're gonna hold your breath, 2, 3, 4, and exhale through your mouth slowly, 2, 3, 4, and then hold, 2, 3, 4. We're gonna repeat that. Breathe in through your nose, 2, 3, 4. Hold your breath, 2, 3, 4. Exhale slowly through your mouth, 2, 3, 4. And then you're gonna hold, 2, 3, 4. Keep your eyes closed, holding on to my voice. Imagine the place that brings you peace. It could be the beach, the ocean, the spa, anywhere that you feel a sense of calm, you feel free and without any restriction or distraction. Where are you in this moment? Are you inside or outside? Visualize this place. What do you see? What are the colors? Are there people there? What does this place look like? What do you hear? Is it quiet? Do you hear slight noises from nature? Are there birds chirping? Is there music playing? Or are you just hearing the natural sounds around you? Can you feel the temperature of this space that you're in? Is it warm? Is it cold? Is there a cool breeze? Is it hot? Can you smell any scents? Is it sweet, fresh, pleasant? Are there food or beverages involved? If so, what does it taste like? Can you imagine indulging of the partaking of this food or beverage? Is it a favorite of yours? What does your palate feel like when you take a sip or a bite? Breathe in slowly again through your nose. Let the breath slowly leave your lips. What are you feeling in your body? Are there goosebumps? Are you calm? Are you relaxed? Is your mind completely empty? Are you smiling inside? Does the sensation you are feeling make you want to shed a tear of happiness? Stay in this space and remind yourself that you deserve this. And you have worked so hard to give yourself this peace that you're feeling right now. Another breath through your nose. Exhale slowly through your lips. Breathe in again, taking in your surroundings. Breathe out again through your mouth. When you're ready, you can open up your eyes. So I guess I would like to just kind of take a moment if anyone would like to share their experience of that.
Okay, if you type in the chat and you want to be unmuted, you can just let us know.
Okay. So this next component that I added to this presentation is a song by Vivian Green that I actually played when I worked in corrections. Back in 2006. And it was actually a song that was really, she was basically kind of just talking about like finding herself and not being distracted from people who were trying to take her away from that sense of peace. So I'm going to play this song. And again, just kind of sitting and listening to the words of this and identifying how you're capturing that for yourself right now in the world and what it is that you're doing.
So ready for the next phase in my life. These days are fulfilling, and I have peace of mind. But every time I get too high, you do your best to knock me down. But I am not who I was back then. You're trying to hurt me, you're really trying. I feel like you owe me. No fighting, fussing, carrying, I'm starting arguments. Why can't I have my peace? I understand why they say misery loves company. But what you fail to see, I hold the power, I am in control. And all things must come to an end. You're trying to hurt me, you're really trying. You're trying, there's no way out. You take what I have found within. Trying so hard to get under my skin. This is a battle that you won. It's fighting, but it's alright.
There's no way I'll ever be unhappy again.
Trying so hard to get under my skin. Trying again, but it's alright. You watch and you wait for. Your 15 minutes of my day, it makes you feel good if you think that you've gotten to me. Funny cause I don't wish nothing bad on you, because the drama's all you wanna put me through. I've made my decision and I'm firm on it, so I don't know why you're even trying. There's no way I'll let you take what I have found again.
It's so hard to get out of my skin.
This is a battle that you won't win, baby.
There's no way I'll ever be unhappy again.
It's so hard to get out of my skin.
Okay, so you all can put like your thoughts. Oh, I'm doing a, hold on. I don't know what just happened. There we go. So you all can put your thoughts about the song, you know, what came of that, what you thought of in the chat if you'd like. And Brittany, I'm sure that we'll have time to kind of talk through any questions that people may have during the panel. That's totally fine. If there's any questions that come up during the course of this, you can also put those in the chat and I'll do my best to kind of go through those and answer those questions for you. But I like this song because, as you can see, that she's really just kind of talking about that place that she has found, that she's doing her hardest, not for anybody on the outside of that to disrupt that peace that she's in. So I want to, challenge you all to promise yourself to do some things. Like, what are you going to do moving forward as an act of loving and caring for yourself? And sometimes, we can say these things, but then we get caught up in our everyday lives. We may say, I want to journal more, I want to go out more, or, I want to spend more time with my family. All those kind of things may come up. But what ends up happening is we get lost in that, right? So look for your accountability partners. If it's me, I can say, Brittany, can you make me accountable to, checking in with me once a week to see if I've journaled twice a week, so that is a way for you to get permission. Oh, I'm so sorry. Hold on one second. Sorry about that. My computer just wants to do more music. Hold on one second.
Like you loved me. Maybe for wrong reasons. Maybe. At first it was beautiful. Every girl has a fairy tale.
Okay, sorry about that. Technical difficulties. hold on one second. All right. Can you guys still see my screen?
No, not right now. You can screen share again.
Okay, hold on one second. Sorry about that, everybody. All right, there we go. One second. Let me go into presenter mode. Okay. Can we see that okay?
Yep, it looks good.
Okay. I just want to turn off this the audio. Hold on. Okay, it'll just do that or whatever. So again, looking for your accountability partners and making sure that you are promising yourself that you're gonna do XYZ and giving your social circle permission to kind of hold you accountable to that. So as we're coming down the final stretch, key points that I want you guys to kind of take away from this. The virus is the enemy, not people. We all share in the vulnerability. None of us are immune to this. Like, any of us can catch this, or we know someone who has this virus. And the best way for us to reduce the stigma is to provide simple support to other people. Making sure that you're taking breaks away from the news and media. There's so much harm and, things that are going on in the world that are hurtful. And sometimes we have to take a break away from that. It can be, overload in our minds. Making sure that you're taking care of your body. And make sure that you make yourself a priority to take time to unwind. So the final thing I want you all to take away is this. Create an atmosphere for yourself that accentuates your power within, rejuvenates your spirit, and energizes the inner you. So again, Brittany and Juliet, thank you so much for welcoming me here to spend part of your afternoon with you to present this information. I hope that you all were able to kind of take away some important kind of aspects and, to better able to kind of, do the work that you're already doing. Or if this was something more personal for you, hopefully this was something that you found to be valuable. So thank you again. My contact information is here if needed. And I'll turn it back over to Juliet.
Thank you. Thank you, Lovea Smith. No, that was great. And that is what we need. We need things for us, by us. And thank you, as a Black medical clinical provider. You did just that. You helped support us where we are as far as our health and wellness. You also is helping us and protecting us to make sure that we don't you know, get COVID, or how do we survive COVID if we do? So thank you for that. You also help the women that who are HIV positive, how they can overcome, you know, the illness by just, you know, having that self-care and knowing that it doesn't define you. So, no, thank you. So this was great. So thank you. You did exactly what our power, our voice, our control is all about. We're trying to come together as a community of Black women to help despair some of the racial inequities that we're facing when it comes to healthcare, just because we're Black or for whatever reason that others put on us. So thank you. This was great. I enjoyed your presentation. And it's interesting how you mentioned about the stats about Black, like 500,000 Blacks, but yet only 7,000 know about PrEP. See, that's what we're talking about. That's what we need to get at. We need to get there to that point that we can have our own for you, by you health promotions too. And actually with our power, our voice, our control, we are going to have a two talk campaign. So I would like you to be a part of that, so that we can get the message out there about self-care and the importance on PrEP.
Oh, okay, great. Just keep me posted, and we can definitely talk more about that offline.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Go ahead, Brittany.
All right, so now we're gonna go into our panel discussion. I think Lovea's presentation was a good segment or segue into this next portion. So now I want to welcome in Latanya Morris, and I'll give her a formal introduction as well. Latanya Morris is the founder of the V Doctor Natural Feminine Care, where she provides education on feminine health gene and promotes products that are safe, effective, and chemical-free. She currently works as a certified PA in emergency medicine with U of C Healthcare System. She has worked in medicine since 2006 as a PA since 2011. In addition to her career and business, she was also Miss Illinois in 2019, competing in the Miss America pageant, where she devoted her platform to encourage people to dream big. Above all of this, she is a full-time single mother of a special needs child with autism that is the light of her life. Due to this, she is actively supports the Autism Speaks organization. So it is with great pleasure that we are welcoming her to this panel discussion, also with her expertise in this area as well. So I'm going to go ahead and just get started. I'm going to throw out the first question, and Lovea's here as well to answer any questions about self-care. But why do you think or believe Blacks are hesitant about getting the COVID test and hesitant about getting the COVID vaccination? And you could give your answer specifically to people who are HIV positive as well.
Is that towards me, Lovea, or either of us?
Either of you can answer this question. And every now and then I may chime in too with some opinions.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, right now, obviously, it's fear of the unknown. And I think that's just for everybody. I don't think it's necessarily for Blacks, but it's for everybody. But what I do know with us, in particular with Black people, we've been used as guinea pigs for everything. And, you know, because we're viewed as less than human. And so because of that, you know, the fear is kind of innate. Like, okay, there's something new and they want to test it and they want to test it out on us, you know? So at this point, we know that for herd immunity, meaning that for it to resolve, they want 85% of the population vaccinated. I'm personally not against the vaccine, but kind of like everyone else, I'm standing back just to watch first, and then, you know, I'll join in. So I think, like I said, for the most part, you know, we don't want to be guinea pig. We don't want to be things to be tested on us. The vaccine is very new. They don't even know much about the illness within itself, let alone to create a vaccine within a 1 year time frame. Typically, it takes 2 years at minimum to create a vaccine for anything we've ever had. So this is the quickest vaccine that's been out for an illness that we know nothing about. Like, we learn about this thing as we go. So just that fear and, you know, knowing those things that I just said, it's a wait and see game for us and for most Black people.
I'll kind of echo some of that what LaTanya mentioned, you know, just going back to the Tuskegee experiment, you know what I mean? Like what Tanya was kind of alluding to, you know, we don't want to be guinea pig, you know? And so having that kind of experience being historically documented and then mm-hmm. to have something like this come up for us, it's like, we're really not sure if that's something that we should be trusting of. And we already have like a distrust of medical providers, you know, and even though I'm a mental health professional, that still falls under like, you know, health and wellness and things of that nature. And so there's always these different kind of ideas that we have about like, we shouldn't trust individuals who are in the medical field. They're lying to us. It's part of the government, you know, and mental health is not something that we're supposed to take seriously. You're supposed to keep that stuff in-house, you know, all of those kind of things. And so it can definitely be something that is hard to kind of get across, but, you know, we have to also be mindful of the fact that that comes from something that's just not something that we've made up in our minds over time.
Absolutely.
All right, that's perfect. And I'm going to move on to the next question. How can medical providers re-engage or reassure individuals with HIV that they are not alone?
I'll start it then. What I know most when it comes to medicine, what I hear the most is that we don't listen. So it's I think it's less about us talking and giving reassurance and more about us listening to the needs and concerns that the patients have, and then providing support groups. It's not a lot out there as far as support groups are concerned. You know, how it affects you, not just physically, but mentally. And you know that the government, they shut down a lot of those programs that we had, unfortunately. So I think that if we can get some of those support groups back, and if as medical providers, we actually have the time to really listen to what our patients are experiencing, what they're going through, then that will open up more of a trust between the patient and the mm-hmm. provider.
And then Lovea, did you want to add anything to that question?
No, I think Tanya summed it up pretty nicely. Yeah.
I agree.
Yeah.
And I'll say too, it's so crazy right now, and I don't know, maybe a few months ago, you know, I work in one of the facilities I work at is an urgent aid facility, and we got a grant. And with this particular grant, we offer free HIV testing to every single patient that walks in the door. So even though it's an urgent care facility, if you come in and you hurt your finger, you're just there like, man, I stubbed my finger. I just want an x-ray. It's swollen. I got to say, hey, we do free HIV testing. You want it? It's a quick blood draw. So literally every patient that walks through that door right now, at this moment, it doesn't matter what you come in for, gets offered free HIV testing. And I thought that was something that was excellent because, you know, of course, it's a weird question. They look at us like, well, I'm not here for that, but it's free. Okay. And with that, you know, someone, you know, will always call them with results. And obviously there's someone there as far as to consult with in the event, you know, something's positive. So I do see some subtle changes being made within the community of providers and that I work with and the network that I work with.
I think that normalization part of it is really, really key. You know, like you said, they didn't come in for the HIV, but the fact that it was readily available makes it that much more easy for you to be able to say, okay, I can go ahead and get it, you know, because oftentimes what ends up happening is, you know, I know in a lot of the communities, and just like what I presented earlier, is that a lot of medical providers are not like talking about like what the options are. You know, when I go and I get my annual kind of checkups, I'm actually going through and saying, hey, I want to be tested for everything. I mean everything. Because most of the time, and LaTanya can kind of attest to this, that most of the time, you know, your panel that you're going to get is gonorrhea and chlamydia. You have to actually ask for syphilis. You have to ask for herpes. You have to ask for HIV. So if you're not telling your provider to give you a whole panel and test you for everything, they're not going to do that. So you could go through a lifetime of not knowing what diseases or infections that you may be carrying. And it's because that there is a lack of care and attentiveness on the provider's kind of behalf to actually kind of go through and say, okay, we're going to test you for all of these things, especially in our communities, because we don't know the questions to ask. We don't know that it's important for us to have a primary doctor as well as an OBGYN. So we want to make sure that we're covering all bases of that. And, you know, the more normal and in the conversation that we can have that, the better that we can push people into the direction of getting the holistic care that they actually deserve. Because a lot of times, and even in my sessions with my clients, you know, I always say that if mentally you're not okay, that's going to play on you emotionally, that's going to break you down on your body. So, you know, if you get a diagnosis of HIV, just think of how that's going to like disrupt your whole mental kind of conception. You're like, where did I get this from? You're angry, you're in denial, all these kind of things. And then emotionally, that's going to break you down. And then what then happens, you start to get backaches, you get headaches, you get all of these kind of things, this somatic kind of complaints. And if you're not addressing those things, that can go into long-term kind of bodily kind of breakdowns. So if you're not going to your physical, you know, you're not going to a primary doctor to kind of get like holistic kind of care and treatment, then you're just missing part of the component. So health means all aspects of you. It does not just mean that you go and get your girlfriend looked at. You have to also get your blood drawn to see how your cholesterol levels are. You have to make sure that, you know, if you're having aches and pains in your body, that you're going to see the right specialist for that. And you're asking those questions, and don't be afraid to open up and ask, because this is your body, you know, and you're living with your body 24/7. Nobody's with you 24/7 but yourself. So if you don't ask the questions, you won't get the answers, and it'll always be no.
Thank you. Thank you both. That was excellent. And I really like how Dr. Morris, you stated, yeah, you came in for a Band-Aid, but how about an HIV test? Because that's what we want. We want to see that it's being normalized. And the reason why that question came up, because all of the attention, the resources and the services and large amount of funds are being diverted to COVID-19. Mm-hmm. And some people, and I do know some of them have brought this to me, some people who are HIV positive felt like, what about us? Did they forget about us? You know, this still is a pandemic. You know, there's no vaccination. In fact, someone said, yeah, what happened to that vaccination for HIV? Did they just hurry up and sped past that? And so that's why. And I remember all the hashtags. I was sitting at home. You're not alone. We're in this together. But put that on HIV. I remember, 25 plus years ago, that wasn't being said about HIV. Mm-hmm. You know, we weren't all coming together. And so thank you both for that. For that added needed, that what you need to do when you go to the doctor. So thank you both. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
There was a question in the QA section, and I guess it's more directed towards me. I did answer it, but I wanted to just kind of pose it to the group. Mm-hmm. But the question was, how do you say no to others without feeling guilty about it and knowing that you may have other plans? So this is a question I get all the time in therapy. Saying no doesn't mean that you're being mean or that you don't care about an individual. Sometimes you have to kind of say no when you're stretched too thin. If your body is telling you that you need to rest, your body is telling you that you need to sleep, you need to eat, you have all of these signals in your body that is going to signal that you need something. If you fall down, like Latanya was talking about, if you fall down and you hurt yourself, the neurons in your brain or the synapses in your brain are going to fire off these neurons that are going to come down to your limbic system and be like, ah, I'm in pain, like I hurt my, you know, and it happens very, very quickly, right? Now, let's say you might have hurt yourself like very significantly and you just go and you just push through and you're like, you know what? It was just a bruise. It's, you know, and then over time it's getting worse. It's getting worse. It's getting worse. So what you've done is you've just prolonged getting treatment. And that's the same thing that we do with our bodies. You know, you might have this, like I'm out of water and I see Latanya's drinking water, but I got these little bitty droplets of water in this bottle, right? But everybody on this panel, or everybody in this Zoom, they need a sip of this. How am I supposed to stretch out these droplets to all of these people and I don't have enough? So that's basically what we do. We stretch ourselves way too thin because we don't want to say no. We don't want to feel guilty. And then we run the risk of burning ourselves completely out. And then you're shut down. And then you're in the corner somewhere hovering and you holding yourself and you can't figure out like, why is it that you're breaking down from the smallest thing. And it's like, I've been strong and I've been taking on all of this stuff. And now all of a sudden, you know, I got a call from somebody who told me that they couldn't show up for me. And I just broke down. I completely lost it. And it's like, why did that break me down? It's because like, even when you exercise, if you're continuously pushing and you're doing those reps, in between those reps, you have to give yourself a break. So if you're pushing yourself to the brink, you are exhausting yourself completely, even though exercise is good for you, even though being there to support another person is good because it does take a village to show up for other people, but you also have to show up for yourself and you also have to give yourself rest time in between that. So if you have plans and you really just can't do it or you really just don't feel like doing it, saying no doesn't mean that you can't be there in other times. You know, you just have to make sure that you're paying attention to what your body is telling you. So being mindful of that is going to be very, very key. And Latanya, I don't know if you want to talk more to that as well too.
Yeah, I'll speak to that. It's funny, the word no gives a negative connotation. And so it sounds bad when you say no. And I remember telling because I have a life coach that I see a therapist. And I remember one year coming in and I'm like, this is my year of the no. You know, like, yeah, I'm saying no to everything I want to do. I'm saying it's my year of the no. And I let it be known. I put it on Facebook, everything. This is my year of the no. And she kind of corrected me in that sense, said, no, this is your year of yes. So it's no to them, but it's the yes to you. So it's a yes to my peace. Yes to the things I want to do. Yes to my decisions. So it's not selfish. It's more selfless. Like she said, you have to teach people how to treat you. You know, so you have to treat yourself well first. If you don't, they're going to treat you how you treat yourself. You stretch yourself thin and you allow it, people will take a foot if you give them an inch. Mm-hmm. And so they're like, well, she let me do it this time. I mean, next time I can do it again. And I'm going to ask for more and ask for more. And like she said, eventually your cup is going to empty. Mm-hmm. So, you know, self-care is the best type of care, always. So the year of the yes. So don't even worry. It's not a no. It's not a no to them. It is a yes to you.
I like that.
Yeah. I was going to say, it's so funny you say that. I actually spoke to a coach about an executive coach 2 weeks ago. And that's kind of like her mantra too, is how do you give joy to yourself? And it is by saying yes, yes to yourself. How do you love yourself? You say yes to yourself. So I think that's, really good advice. I think that's great advice. And I may steal that from you.
So. You can have it, girl. You can have it. Everybody share it. Put it on the wall, write it down somewhere. Okay. Yes to you.
Well, this is great. So I'm gonna throw out one more question to really all of us, and then I'm gonna start taking some questions from the audience. We do want to give you guys the opportunity to ask any of the ladies here a question, whether it's self-care, whether it's HIV specific, anything that you have on your mind. So are the medical doctors informing their patients about HIV prevention? We touched on this a little bit while we are in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic. So do you guys think that's happening? Do you think it's not happening? I kind of have my own take on that as well.
I mean, unfortunately, I think everything got pushed under the rug. When COVID hit, I mean, when I say everything, I mean, people were at home having heart attacks and strokes, you know? All the procedures got canceled. It was just like the world just really shut down. So unfortunately, you know, things took a seat, including some very important things like HIV. I do see with things opening back up, like I said, in my clinic, because so much money was lost during COVID, there's these grants that are out now, you know, money and things that we didn't have access to before are coming back, and they're actually coming back better than what it was before, because they see the need now. It just kind of brought things to the forefront. Like, hey, we forgot about that. So, you know, now that it put everything on the same field, because at one time, everything was forgotten about. now at one time is bringing it all back. It's like, well, let's bring this back too. Let's bring this back too. Let's bring that back too. So, you know, it's kind of like a double-edged sword. It was bittersweet.
Yep.
So like I said, you know, we got the grant because we needed funding. We lost a lot of money to hospitals. Believe it or not, the hospitals lost a lot of money during COVID because people were not coming in. We told patients, if you're not dying, stay at home, and they did. So we lost a lot of money. We were looking for the grants. And one of the big grants we got, like I said, was the HIV testing. And so now we're like, hey, you walk through that door. I know you stubbed your toe, but let me draw some blood real quick for HIV. So that worked out. And we have to have so many draws in order to get the grant. So it's like, yeah, we asking everybody.
That's true. That's true.
You know what I mean? Like, we got a quota to meet. Hey, let me draw your blood real quick.
And that is true. You know, and you know what's so interesting about that? And when you don't come up with a positive person, they like frown upon it. But that means our prevention work is working.
Right. Right.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So we talked about self-care earlier, and this was a comment that I actually saw early on in the chat, but we can all sort of answer this, but what specifically do you do or as a part of your self-care routine, or can you give us like the thing that you have to give yourself? And then Latanya, I'm going to start with you first. Lovea, I'm gonna stick you at the end of that, if that's okay.
Totally fine. Totally fine.
And Juliet, I hate to say, I'm gonna have you answer this too.
That's fine.
Okay. Yeah, mine is not that deep. I'm not gonna lie. It's not. The one thing I need every day is a nap. Okay. I'm sorry. I gotta get me some sleep because I'm up all night. I'm up all day. I'm working full time over here. I'm an entrepreneur. I'm a full time mama. If y'all don't give me 30 minutes, so I need a quiet corner. I need a nap. Like, so that's my peace. That's my me time. You know, sleep is literally my favorite pastime. When people ask, what do you like to do? I promise you, I say sleep. I love to get me some rest. So I feel rejuvenated after that. So one thing I'm going to do, I'm going to sleep and I'm going to have me a good meal.
That sounds great. Okay. Juliet, you and the audience, if you want to type a couple things in the chat, you're welcome to share what you do for yourself as well.
Now mine is easy too. I love sleep, but I haven't been getting a lot of sleep. For me, right now I have problems with my feet, so I got to massage on me at night and in the morning. If I don't do that, I'm freaking mad. I may even go home or don't go to work. I'm being honest. That's me. I need that stuff.
I guess mine is pretty simple too. So I did a virtual conference on January 1st, and we had the speaker who talked about the importance of buying flowers for your space. Lovea, I think you remember that. Yeah. So every single time I order groceries, which is a lot because I have three toddlers, I order some flowers too. So my kitchen is like filled with flowers now. And it every morning when I get up, it just brings me so much joy to see it. So that's my thing.
My thing every day is definitely sleep. I had a nap before this started. Hey. I had my sinuses were really bad last night, and I woke up in the middle of the night at like 2 something in the morning, and I was like, oh, I'm gonna be a mess on this doggone training. So I was like, I had to actually schedule in when I was gonna do a nap. So sleep, if I don't know why kids don't like to nap, like it's the best thing ever. It's the best thing ever. And then I also have to get in a little bit of prayer time, you know, so even if it's just like a thank you, Lord, or whatever the case may be, you know, I actually have to kind of give that to myself. So yes, the rest and just praying. So that's every day. Now, if we're talking about long-term type of stuff, or, you know, I have to always kick it in the booze. I have to have my boo time. Sometimes I have me a little cocktail at the end of the week. And, you know, on a daily, I always have music because I feel like music, for some reason, it, you know, whatever mood you're in, I mean, you have a song that can relate to some type of mood you're in. If it's sadness, if it's happiness, if you're feeling like, you know, doing some praising, whatever that looks like, you know, music is also like just so therapeutic. So.
Mm-hmm. That's perfect. And I see some other people commenting in the chat as well. So Teresa says, yeah, she prays and she gets plenty of rest. I don't know what sleep is right now because of the three toddlers, but I hope to know what it is again in like a year or two, we'll see. And then we have Felicia Davis here, who's the CEO of the Chicago Foundation for Women. She says she also loves flowers. Nice to have you here. tomorrow she loves baths. I love baths too. That's one of my things. Candles, good music. Music is definitely a thing. So Lovea, I'm really happy you played that song for us earlier because it's always like a great addition. So
absolutely. I have a question over here in the Q&A as well. So we're kind of going back to the COVID vaccine. So to be safe, is it to get the COVID vaccine better to be safer than not safe at all? People not vaccinated are more likely to catch COVID than a person not vaccinated. Am I right or am I wrong? I feel safer being vaccinated. So I'll start it since I read it, but I definitely agree with you that, you know, whatever you feel that is gonna keep you feeling safe, you should go ahead and do that. You know, we're not saying that you should not get vaccinated. We're not saying that you should get vaccinated. We're not saying any of that. I think everybody has their own opinion about what this vaccination is. And so if you feel more comfortable with getting that vaccine, then you go right ahead and you do that. You know, I don't think that there's anything wrong with that. And I think that, you know, we're just sharing kind of our own opinions and we were basically just kind of answering the question of why is it that the Black community could be a little bit biased to getting it? And we were just talking about the historical kind of reasons as to why that might be some struggles for people to kind of get on board with that. You know, when the COVID kind of hit, most of our people were the ones who were being affected by it, you know, because we were, you know, we have, and then we have more deaths that were reported as well too, because we're living in poverty, we have unstable housing, we're living in food deserts. So all of those things are impacting the reasons why we could not survive this, because there were these underlying conditions that kind of exacerbated on top of the COVID, which took a lot of us out, right? So when the COVID vaccine kind of happened, yes, it does seem like, you know, more of the Black community is getting it because so many of our people were dying from that. So, you know, I'm basically just kind of saying that, you know, what you feel comfortable with doing, I think that there's no right or wrong answer to that. I think it's people's own personal opinions. I think that, you know, everybody doesn't get a flu vaccine. That doesn't necessarily mean you have to get the COVID vaccine. I think it's what you feel that's best, you know, based on what you're seeing around you and what you feel most comfortable with doing. And I'll turn it back over to the medical providers to kind of echo any of that.
Thank you. Yep, it's definitely a personal choice. But in making it a personal choice, like anything else, you know, like I'm not vaccinated. So with that being said, I'm going to be more cautious. You know, I'm going to wear my mask. I'm going to practice personal hygiene as far as washing my hands more often, sanitizing my area, cleaning things more often. And that may take a little bit more time to do, but it's necessary because I know I'm not vaccinated. And I've had so much exposure to COVID because of where I work and what I do. Personally, you can't tell me that I didn't have it already. You know, I didn't get tested. I never tested positive, but
right.
I believe at some point in time, it passed through me. It passed through my system. But with that being said, I think it's more so of taking the necessary precautions as far as what we're doing with the masks, the shields, the hand washing, the cleaning the areas. You know, even when it comes to people like, oh, my rights have been violated because I don't wanna wear this mask in public. I feel like that's a violation to the person who you're around, the people you're around, more so than for yourself. You know, it's like protect them. So if you feel some type of way about wearing a mask, and y'all know that y'all seen the videos of the people like, I don't want to wear my mask in public. You know, and I feel like the people that they're around, they're exposing, and that's not fair. So again, vaccines are a personal choice. For me, on a personal level, I have a son with autism. And he up until the age of 2, he was diagnosed at 2, but prior to 2, he was very quote unquote normal. And I use the air marks for normal because we don't even know what that really is. Needless to say, he started developing these symptoms after, you know, getting all his vaccines, this, that, and the other. And I'm not saying the vaccines caused it. I'm saying we don't know. And because you don't know, you can't tell me, is this why my child has it? I kind of feel indifferent against vaccines. You know, it's a double-edged sword for me. It's a good thing. It's a bad thing. At the end of the day, it's a personal choice. And until they mandate it, until you tell me you have to get this, then I'm going to make the decision that I believe for myself. Like Lovea said, some people don't have a flu shot. I have to get the flu shot at my job. You can't walk in them doors during flu season unless you turned in your slip that you got your flu shot. It is mandated for me, but that's not for everybody else. Right now, COVID is not mandated. I'm pretty sure it will be, but until for me personally, you say you got to get it, then I won't. I've been very safe with my mask, with washing my hands, with cleaning my area. I'm going to continue to do that. I feel like it's just as effective as the vaccine. I'm eating healthier. I'm doing more with my vitamins. I think we've amped up on our regimens of taking our echinacea and our CMOS and all of that. Okay, now we in tune with holistic medicine, right? So that's a plus. That's a plus.
So it looks like we're at least 10 after the hour. So what I want to do now is give you guys an opportunity to share any final thoughts or comments that you have in regards to these topics. So first, I'm going to actually start with Lovea, since you kicked us off, if you could kick us off on the conclusion as well.
Okay. Put me on the spot. Well, I just, you know, like I said, final takeaway for me, for people, is to make sure that you are taking care of yourself in all facets, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, sexually. All of those are components of you. You know, when you compartmentalize yourself, then you are missing key pieces of who you are that needs to be tended to. If you need to have that primary care physician, you need to go and get that done. You know, making sure that your weight is together, making sure that emotionally you're checking in with yourself, making sure that if you need to see therapy, and I think that, you know, honestly, we all probably need to see a therapist, you know, because we're all going through, you know, we're all going through this pandemic, right? And oftentimes we're being looked at as the people who are professionals, but that doesn't mean that we're not human. You know, we're going through the same kind of things that everybody else is going through. We have the same kind of levels of stress, and yet we are taking on the traumas and, you know, the pain of everybody else. You know, Tanya works in, you know, OBGYN. She's hearing the traumas of people probably coming in saying that they've lost their babies or they miscarried, you know, and then she has to jump from one patient to another. So it's like she's saddened with this patient, but then she's going to the next room and somebody's excited that they just learned that they're pregnant. So we're going through a wave of emotions that, ourselves. So it's important that even we're pouring into you all, that we ourselves have to take care of ourselves, because we're at the front line. We're being looked at as the experts. So making sure that us, as the ones that are in the limelight, if you will, that we're taking very good care of ourselves, because we are the ones that are being looked at as examples. So that's my takeaway.
Thank you.
Latanya, I'm going to pick on you next.
No problem. Absolutely. Just really, really quick, I'm just gonna make a quick point. With the COVID vaccines, understand that just because you get the vaccine does not mean you can't catch COVID. I want to make sure it is not 100% effective against catching COVID. You absolutely can still catch COVID, number one. Number two, it does increase the rate it decreases your ability to become very sick if you get COVID. So if you get COVID, it just gives you more immunity, to the sense that you won't get sick and die. That's really what the vaccines is about. So it's less about I can't catch it, than more about if I catch it, I won't die from it. So I just want to make sure we're clear about that. As far as my takeaway, when it comes to care in general, like Lovea mentioned, she mentioned the Trinity. I believe in that holistically, mind, body, and soul. Like the whole thing has to be taken care of, because again, like if you've got a wound physically that you can see, if you are not mentally stable, it will not heal. Period. It will not heal. So, you know, I get patients all the time coming in asking me, you know, when they get diagnosed with diabetes or high blood pressure or whatever, well, and I got to put them on medication, and they go, how long do I have to take this? And I say, that's up to you. You tell me how long you want to be on this. You want to lose 10 pounds, you know? So it's all a whole thing of mental, physical, you know, spiritual health. And if you don't have a provider, you need to get one. And as women, we do need to. OBGYN and primary care. You need to. OBGYN, I cannot stress that enough, in primary care. If you're not comfortable with your provider, switch.
Find another one.
Get another provider. You absolutely, it's imperative that you are comfortable with the person that you are seeing. So much to the point that you can open up to them about anything, because we have to know everything in the treatment process. Absolutely. So you know, that's my takeaway on, you know, self-care, you know, starting with health, getting your providers, getting your annual exams, and being with somebody you're comfortable with.
Absolutely.
Thank you. And Julian, I'm just going to toss it back to you.
Okay. I'd like to thank everyone for tuning in to our, like I said, third series of our health series brought for you by Black medical and clinical providers. Actually, Black medical and female clinical providers, or is it women? Which one? But thank you all. I wanted to thank Dr. Martin for also her, you know, spearheading everything and moderating the series so far. So thank you very much. I'd like to thank Lovea Smith. And I'd like to also thank Dr. Morris for tuning in and giving us the information, the tools that we need to help to continue to empower us. I also would like to thank Dr. Lorraine Burroughs, who is our CEO, founder, and president of Universal Family Connection. We are a social service agency. And I want to say, you know, they didn't view social service workers as essential, but no, the staff at UFC is very, very essential. And they were there. We were there doing the shelter in place. We were there doing virtual programming. We never skipped a beat. So I'd like to thank, you know, shout out to our UFC staff. Also, I'd like to thank the risk reduction department for tuning in, for our risk reduction team. Thank you for your efforts. And also, I'd like to give a special shout out to the BW Self, the Black Women Supporting Empowering Lifestyle Factors, because this series right here is what it's all about, for us, by us. And you know, one of the questions that I have in my flyer is, are you ready to right the wrongs caused by the medical community that have led to mistrust? Yes, we are doing that. Thank you, Lovea Smith, and thank you, Dr. Morris and Dr. Martin. You are doing just that. We're bringing solutions. We're not complaining. We didn't complain. We brought solutions to the table for Black women as a community, not individual. Never once you. Yeah, it was about self-care, but it's also self-care for everyone. It's also can benefit everyone. I'd like to thank you. And one of my coworkers, I am going to put her on the spot, Karen Eddy, she mentioned how she became so frustrated because during this COVID time, a lot of resources like IE money, a lot of stimulus money has been being put forth towards the clients, and the clients didn't want to come in for the employment. They don't need employment. So I wanted her to say, no, your work, keep it up. You're doing what you're doing. You're providing the resources, because we don't want the resources to go away, because then they'll never be there again for another pandemic or for another day. It don't have to be a pandemic for those resources to be there. So I wanted to just cheer her on and continue to be a central provider of services during this time of COVID. So thank you. Thank you, ladies. And thank you, everyone. I really appreciate the talk and the learning. I learned so much. And we are going to have you all, you'll have to be a part of the video production. You have to get that out there. It's going to be every month going to have videos out there on social media. We have to capture the essence of what you brought here today. So thank you, ladies. Thank you.
Thank you for having us so much. Enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you. All right. See you guys back soon. April 15th is our next one.
Yes. And also, and thank you, Chicago Department of Public Health. They are our partner that brought us to this structural intervention. And also, we are also having a COVID care group. It's not about a support group, but it's about a COVID group, candid conversations. And it's going to start April the 6th. And I think you all will be so very instrumental in that as well. Thank you. Thank you, ladies.
Jessica Bailey wants our contact information. I know.
Sure. We will provide all of that information. Also, they also wanted your information to Lovea Smith. Yep. So thank you. We will.
We have everyone's email address. We'll actually package that in one email, and then we'll send it out to you guys.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. See you guys back soon.
Bye-bye. Thank you again.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.